Would you die for me?
Yes.
Yeah, I live for these moments with you.
I'm all yours.
The Joker and Harley Quinn are unpredictable.
They are the king and queen of Gotham City. Talk about a romance gone wrong.
Come on, Puddin'. Do it!
You don't know whether Harley's gonna, like, laugh, hug you, or, like, shoot you in the face.
Stupid bats! You're ruining date night!
And then Joker's, like, even worse than that.
I think that the Joker is probably better known than the devil.
Some might say that the Joker is the most famous bad guy in the DC universe.
The trick was to be incredibly respectful of the legacy of the Joker and not tamper with that, yet at the same time, reinvent the Joker. And Jared pulled that high wire act off.
What?
Oh, I'm not gonna kill you. I'm just gonna hurt you. Really, really.
When I got the call, I had this simultaneous feeling of excitement and dread, maybe is the right word, because it's not something that you really should do. Logically, this role has been interpreted so beautifully, but then there's the other side. What else can you uncover? What other parts of this story, of this life, what can you do that hasn't been done? That side of me that likes exploration, that likes adventure, that likes to push the envelope, that was set on fire immediately. I knew that I was going to have to dive really deep and go to a place that I'd never gone before.
Oh, this looks neat.
So during the process of figuring out the Joker and helping Jared create that character, I kind of had to say goodbye to Jared. There was a point where he went away and he was replaced slowly and surely by the Joker.
Are you kidding me? Ah! Some people just don't know when to die.
And it was a fascinating process to watch. Jared's this really nice guy. He's a good guy. There's a lot of depth to him. He's a very thoughtful person. The Joker is not someone you would say is a really good guy.
Oh, look at all you scary people.
And because the character of the Joker is so out there. I mean, he's an anarchist. He's crazy. Jared's process of digging as deep as he did was one in which we wanted to support.
Once he was on the set, his voice changed, and he only spoke as Mr. J. Conducted himself as Mr. J. You really couldn't connect with him unless you called him J, Mr. J, Joker. And, you know, it creates an interesting set dynamic when somebody does that.
Everybody gets to sit in the chair. I start with you.
I would go into his trailer and have a conversation with him, and I remember the first time that happened, I was pausing because I realized I was actually having a conversation with Mr. J and not necessarily Jared.
That's right. Welcome. Welcome to my nightmare.
I was in another world. I was in another universe. It's exactly where I needed to be. And it was an incredible experiment, incredible exercise. So, you know, disappearing, going into that rabbit hole was something I never expected.
When we started to discover who the Joker was and what was like what his process was, we were all like, oh my god, this is freaking genius. I mean, what he was doing was genius.
We continued, my friend, I have a feeling.
To see the cast react to what Jared was doing in a way that they did, when they're all in a scene together, you can feel that energy, you can feel that terror that they feel about what he's gonna do next, who he is, how crazy he is.
I could tell you meant that.
Yeah. You're gonna be my friend.
I saw the Joker as a modern guy who lives in our world who has a lot in common with contemporary gangsters and is of that culture.
I can't wait. This is gonna be a lot of fun.
When Jared came, the makeup and the hair was the first starting point, and that ended up leading the process with him.
Free, my man.
Beautiful.
Lamb chops.
One interesting thing that happened is we explored the purple suit a lot. It was decided it's just too much with all of the tattoos and the hair and everything. So we pared it right down, and really it was to give Jared room to let him play the character and be not overwhelmed with stuff.
Are you sweet talking me?
I love this guy. He's so intense.
The interesting thing about this Joker, it's more like the comic books. You do see like the more traditional look of the Joker. Really dark green hair, white skin. I love it because he's got the detail of metal teeth, because at some point someone knocked his teeth out. So to have a version of the Joker in this and have this cool relationship with Harley Quinn, which is relatively new to the age of comic books, it's really fun to see. It's exciting to bring that new element, I think, to film.
There is something you could do for me, Doctor.
Anything, I mean, yeah.
I need a machine gun.
A machine gun?
Harley is by far the most famous female villain in the DC universe. People have been waiting for Harley Quinn to hit the big screen.
What?
Harley Quinn's a new addition. Like only 5 or 6 years ago, she became a member of the Suicide Squad and really anchored that team in a brand new way.
What a ride!
Margot really settled into an incredibly difficult role. To be that spontaneous and be that humorous and be that soulful and be that powerful and tough, Margot worked very, 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 very hard to get there.
Boy, play with me.
That is a whole lot of pretty and a whole lot of crazy.
When I researched Harley Quinn and the origins of a Harlequin, was always like to be like this mischievous little sidekick. And I thought it was important to keep that element that she always wants to be a sidekick to someone, but she's being really mischievous about it, and that's what she finds so fun.
Harley Quinn, nice to meet ya. Love your perfume. What is that, the scent of death?
She seems nice. It was kind of cool because a lot of the other characters were obviously playing it like, I don't want to be here, I don't want to be with any of you guys. But for Harley, I played it that she was just like, yay, like first day of school, so many people to play with, this is gonna be great.
Something tells me a whole lot of people are about to die.
It was like walking into like a toy store and being like, what do I do first? I can mess with you, I can mess with you.
Hey, if you like a girl, can you light her a cigarette with your pinky? Because that would be real classy.
Her character, I mean, she's a complete psychopath in many ways. Yet there's something that like draws you in, right? She's a beautiful girl, but she's a very self-destructive individual. But she's really, I mean, she's just really interesting to watch.
Hey, come on.
What? I saw it move. See? I flinched, I think.
That was really important to definitely explore her flaws. And David is the guy that's gonna delve deeper than anyone for those flaws. I feel like human instinct sometimes to want to be portrayed in a positive light.
Oh. Now that's killer out.
And David would always sway us the other way. He's like, no, if he's upset right now, you should say something mean to him right now, because that's what she would do.
When I get mad, I lose control, you know. I don't know what I do till it's done.
The kids?
He killed them. Didn't you? And so it was really painful at times. We're doing really emotional scenes, and you'd have a character, like Jay's character, or someone really pouring their heart and soul out, and David would come and whisper in my ear and be like, now's when you stab him.
Own it! What'd you think was gonna happen, huh?
Hey, Harley, come on.
To really dig in and sting them when they were down, that was in her nature, and I couldn't avoid that. I had to explore that as much as I explored, like, the funny side to her.
Don't they say about the crazy ones?
Huh?
The look is insane, and the hair and makeup was a real process. I mean, it was a 3-hour process every single day. We'd do the body paint, completely paint me white. Then there were 20 tattoos to put on and a wig, and then the makeup, and then whatever cuts and bruises, you know, Harley had acquired by that point in the film. So a 3-hour process. It was fun, though. It's always like the best time to get into your character, and once you look like that, you kind of, I feel ready, like I feel like I'm Harley.
Seriously, the hell's wrong with you people?
We're bad guys, it's what we do.
Harley Quinn is extremely fun to watch because you have no clue what she's going to do next.
Come on, baby.
She is an extremely emotional, complex character because she is a female Joker. She really is. I mean, the Joker created her.
Harley!
She's a strong character in her own right. She's not defined by the Joker anymore, even though they have a relationship, which I really love.
Pardon? You got all dressed up for me?
Oh, you know I'd do anything for you. By the way, I've got some grape soda on ice and a bearskin rug waiting.
So in Suicide Squad, part of the story is this really epic romance between Joker and Harley.
In the comics, there's been a lot of different versions where it's a little bit antagonistic, it's not a healthy relationship often. And this is like Harley and the Joker, like Bonnie and Clyde in the DC Universe.
It's a fascinating love story because is it love-love, is it love-hate? There's a lot of ways to argue what that relationship is and what that relationship means.
Harley, she is the fire in my loins. The itch in my crotch. The one, the only, the infamous Harley Quinn.
Pardon? Oh. You want me?
Oh, come to daddy.
That relationship is so interesting. It's just so filled with turmoil, and it's one of those relationships where they're so attached to each other and it's so dark that they can't get enough of each other.
He married me.
It's the very first time in a movie that I've ever been on where on day two of shooting on production, it was just Jared and Margot shooting that day, and the entire crew, You just kind of look around and their jaws are on the floor because they're watching something so special and so unique.
You dirty pervert. Oh my God. You people, what are you looking at? Shut up!
It was like pure entertainment for the crew.
There we go. In action!
Get off me! Get What do we have here?
The Harley Joker stuff was so unpredictable. Like the squad stuff, we had done so much rehearsal and we needed to because it bonded us in a way that none of us ever expected would happen, obviously. But the Joker stuff, Jared and I didn't really do any rehearsals off screen.
Cut on rehearsal. Cut on rehearsal.
It's really scary.
And it was perfect because then we would get in front of the camera and I didn't know what was gonna happen, and he didn't know what was gonna happen, and I don't think anyone really knew what was gonna happen. And that's why those scenes were so electric, because they were so unpredictable.
Okay, honey, it's me and you.
Let's do it.
I was lucky in that I had a pretty phenomenal partner in this. I was really lucky to work with her. Incredibly kind, incredibly patient, which you have to be with the Joker in the room.
Desire becomes surrender.
Surrender becomes power.
You want this?
I do.
Oh, God, you're so good.
When you're acting with Joker, like, I didn't see any of Jared, not for a second. It was Joker, and he's nuts. But whatever the result was, it meant that we got these great, great moments on screen. No matter how far we delve, how many scenes we do, I just feel like I've only scratched the surface of Harley. Like, it's just a character that's like a bottomless pit of, like, issues. I could play Harley for, like, 10 years and be happy.
I think the Joker will live forever. I think that he's in some ways the perfect villain. He has stood the test of time, and there will always be a Joker. You may not think so, but he's there, waiting to chew your bloody face off.